Good day, everyone. For today's lesson, we will be discussing about the 19th century mathematics. So before we start to our lesson, let's have first our objectives. So in this lesson, we will be going to understand the 19th century mathematics and to identify the contribution of mathematicians and its ideas. So let's start now to our topic. So the 19th century has been the starting point of an extraordinary expansion of mathematics. So if we're going to compare mathematics during 19th century to the previous era, we will see that there's a big difference between them, because there was a practice of mathematical professions such as teaching, examining, and research. And because of these things, the mathematical concepts becomes more complex, and most of the powerful abstract mathematical theories in use today was originated in this era, like for example proof of fundamental theorem of algebra by Gauss. So at this point also, we can see that France and Germany were like competing to each other. Why? Because they were up to a great speed at this time. And due to the increasing number of mathematicians in this time, they realized also, why not just they specialize themselves? Instead of calling themselves as mathematicians, why they call themselves as analysts, algebraists, and the likes? And also, at this era, there are many various Latin mathematicians who published their works. So as we expected and assumed, since there was an increasing number of mathematicians in this time, so we will be expecting that there was an increasing of mathematical textbooks and journals. And thus, in each specializations, progress and revolutions occurred. Like for example, from a simple tallying, it became complex equation.
Carl Friedrich Gauss is known as the Queen of Mathematics. Was born on April 30, 1777 at Brunswick, Germany. He died at the age of 77 years old on February 23, 1855 in Göttingen. He managed to experience a full life lived with his parents. He was schooled at the Brunswick in 1791 and later on continued his study with the opportunity of financial assistance by his mother at the University of Göttingen. At the age of 7 years old, Gauss showed an exceptional and excellent skill in calculating mathematical problems at St. Catherine Public School. Together with this skill, he was given a bigger opportunity to practice an exercise that produced excellency by reading an advanced arithmetic book. And Mr. Butner changed the life of Gauss by convincing his father to eliminate the foreseen future of him and let him realize the unusual skill that could produce better future and wealth.
He is the greatest German mathematician. His contribution includes the number theory, geometry, probability theory, potential theory, includes the electromagnetism. Let's talk about first the number theory. It is called also as a higher arithmetic. Then second is the geometry, which includes the shapes, space, pinag-aaralan dun yung space. Yan. Tapos yung pangatlo is yung probability theory, na include syempre yung mga chance ng mga bagay-bagay sa mundo. Tapos yung last is yung potential theory, na includes yung electromagnetism. Syempre alam naman natin yung magnetism, yung pinag-aaralan niya is yung charge. Tapos dalawang aspect niya is yung electricity saka magnetism. Pumunta tayo sa may inventions niya, which is yung una is yung heliotrope. na yung instrument na yon, yung instrument na yung reflect ng sun through beam, maobserbahan siya sa milya-milyang layo. Yung pangalawa is yung magnetometer. Yun, yung instrument niya is yung malalaman mo yung strength sa direction ng isang bagay. Tapos si Fried, si Carl Friedrich Gauss, nanalo siya ng award na ng Copley Award na binibigay ito ng Royal Family rather.
George Friedrich Bernhard Riemann was born on September 17, 1826 at Breslau, Hanover, and he died on July 20, 1866 at the age of 39 years old in Celesca, Italy. His mother and father were both minister and he was second among other six siblings. Also, Riemann was enrolled at University of Göttingen in 1846 to study a theology and pursue the same path of his father at ministry. He encountered an enormous failures, began with his proving about the veracity of the book of Genesis. Riemann's skill in mathematics was exceptional, and the program at his age was considered by his class inefficient and too easy. But later on, he was enrolled in University of Berlin at 1847. He obtained an opportunity and advantage by being a protege of gifted mathematician professors Dirichlet and Jacob. By that, Riemann excelled more in mathematics. He managed a doctorate when he returned back in the University of Göttingen at 1849, in which he successfully defended his thesis to Gauss.
So, good day everyone. I am Joran Bautis and I am here to discuss the contributions of Bernhard Riemann in the field of mathematics. So, first was his contribution in the differential geometry, where he published a lecture that has three sections. The three section was named the treating in turn topological notions, metric relations, and application to physical space. So the next is the Riemann hypothesis. It was said that this contribution of Riemann was related in the field of analytic number theory. It was said that Riemann invented this hypothesis, or Riemann hypothesis, on 1859. The next one is the Riemann integral. He first presented this work of him in the faculty of University of Göttingen on 1854. Fortunately, it was not published in exact year where he presented this, but only until 1868. So for the last contributions that Bernhard Riemann made in the field of mathematics that we include in our discussion was the Riemann mapping theorem. It was said that he invented the Riemann mapping theorem on 1851, and he also included this on his PhD thesis when he was under of Gauss. And the PhD thesis that he made was all about the theory of complex function. That's all. I hope you learned something, and thank you.
August Ferdinand Mobius was born on November 17, 1790, the only child of Johann Heinrich Mobius, a dancing teacher, and Johann Catherine Christine Kehl, a descendant of Martin Luther. His father died when he was 3. In 1820, he got married and had a daughter and 2 sons. August died on September 26, 1868 at the age of 77. He left a legacy by being known as a German mathematician and theoretical astronomer who contributed in geometry and topology and the famous Mobius strip. Also, August was only studying at his home until he reached the age of 13. He started showing interest on mathematics in 1803. He attended college at Kolkata and graduated in the year 1809. After graduating, he went to the University of Leipzig, taking law as his course because of the wish of his family. But in the middle of his first year, he then decided to follow what he wants to instead of law. He took mathematics, astronomy, and physics. In this university, Augustin Karl Mollweld, the discoverer of a true-to-area map projection and some trigonometric formulas, who became his teacher in astronomy and made a great influence to him. Also, Augustin went to Göttingen to study astronomy under Carl Friedrich Gauss, a director of observatory in Göttingen, and the Hill to study mathematics under Johann Friedrich Pfaff, Gauss' teacher, and he completed his doctorate under Pfaff with the topic De Confundentis Occupandis Peccarum Per Planetas and Calculating Methods for the Occultation of Fixed Stars by Planets.
Now, let's talk about the works of August Ferdinand Mobius. So in this part, I divided it into three subjects. First is the geometry, second is the astronomy, and the third is the Mobius trio. So let's start with the geometry. So with geometry, August has four ideas. So first is the derivarizentrische calcul in West Hebsmittel zur analytischen Behandlung der Geometrie on 1827, and it is about analytical geometry. In this book, he introduced homogeneous coordinates and also discussed geometric transformations, in particular projective transformations. Second is the Mobius net. So Mobius net is a configuration that plays a significant role in the development of projective geometry. Third is the Mobius function and Mobius inversion formula. He introduced this idea in 1831 on the paper Über ein besondere Art von Omicron der Rhein. And lastly, in the geometry, is the Lehrbuch der Statik. It was published on 1837. And it is about geometric treatment of statics. It led to the study of systems of lines in space. So that's all for the geometry part. So we have here, next is the astronomy. So he has three books about astronomy. So first is De Confutandis Occultationibus Fixarum Per Planetas, that was published on 1815, and it is about the occultations of the planets. Also, this book was part of his doctorate. Next, the second part for the astronomy is De Hoptatse Der Astronomy, that was published on 1836, and it talks about the principles of astronomy. And lastly, for astronomy, is De Elementa Der Mechanik des Himmels on 1843, and it is about celestial mechanics. And for the last part, for August's works, here is Mobius' trip. So Mobius' trip was not only discovered by him, but also by Johann Benedict Listing, and they both discovered it on 1858. So this Mobius' trip was actually helpful with physics, philosophy, and chemistry. So Mobius' trip in general is a surface with just one side and one boundary component. A Mobius' trip is a two-dimensional surface with only one side. It can be constructed in three dimensions as follows. So you can do your own Mobius' trip, of course, with one strip. So with this strip, you need to rotate it, or you need to turn it into 180 degrees, and then join the two ends.
The life of George Ball is different from other mathematician. Ball was tortured by his father together with his own self. Despite of situation, he managed to become a professional in mathematics. At the age of 16, he was able to be a teacher at Haigang School, and through that, he was given an opportunity to support his family. When he reached his 19-year-old, he began to establish established his own school, and later on with a boarding school at 1840, he also became part of an organization which was Lincoln Topographical Society. In connection with that, he built a name of as a local figure.
So after that biography, si George Bull, nung pinanak siya, later that day, bininyagan na agad siya dahil piling ng mga magulang niya ay mahina siya. Low health, parang anytime pwede siyang kunin ni yun. And then, so nag-decide yung mga magulang niya na pabinyagan agad siya. And then, yun niya, dahil naging pa siya, great mathematician, so nakapag-asawa siya ng pangalan si Mary Everest Bull. And then si Mary Everest Bull ay pamangkin nung pinagpangalanan sa Mount Everest, yung si George Everest. Ayun, kaya famous sila. And then yun, ayun lang. And this contribution, Bull's first work was published titled, medyo mahaba, Researches on the Theory of Analytical Transformation with a special application to the reduction of the general equation of the second order. Yun yung bumangalan. And then, it was published in the Cambridge Mathematical Journal in February 1840. This work led to connection between Bull and the journal's editor, Duncan Perkoo-Harson Gregory. And then in 1844, the Royal Society awarded him a medal for his memoir on a general method in the analysis, which was contributed to the theory of linear differential equation by shifting from the case of the constant coefficient to variable coefficient. And then the innovation in operational method is to acknowledge the operation may or may not be commutable. And then Bull published, after that, Bull published pamphlet titled Mathematical Analytical of Logic. Was also his first work on symbolic logic in 1847. But he later wanted an investigation of the law of thoughts, on which are founded the mathematical theory of logic and probabilities, to be viewed matured statement of his beliefs. Although it was often assumed that Bull disagrees with Aristotle logic, he just wanted to systematize it, and then he intended to give it a solid foundation and broaden its scope of use. And then, when it comes in differential equation, Bull's published two systematic treatises on mathematical subject. The first one is Treatise on the Differential Equation, and then Treatise on the Calculus of Finite Differences in 1859 and 1860. And then by 1857, Bull published on the comparison of transcendence with the sum application, the theory of definite integrals. And then in the treatise, he studied the sum of residues of rational function, where he proved what we call Bull's identity for any real numbers. And then in the theory of Hilbert transform, a generalized of this identity play a significant role. And then, and also yung Bull's inequality, often known as union bound of probability theory, states that probability that at least one of a finite or countable set of events occurs is no more than the sum of probabilities of the individual events. And then, given any proposition involving any numbers of terms, Bull originals and remarkable general symbolic method of logic inference, fully stated in the Law of Thoughts in 1854, allows one to draw conclusion that are logically contained in the premises given any proposition involving any numbers of terms. And then, and the last one is Bull's Boolean logic, is the core concept of Boolean algebra. that forms gates, which all digital electronic circuit and microprocessor based system are constructed up. And then basic digital logic gates perform digital operation and, or, and not, binary numbers. Boole's complex thinking has led in uses he could never have imagined. Taga naman. Such as telephone switching, electronic computers, which employs binary digits and logical elements on rely on Boolean logic for their design and functioning. So, he also developed a broad probabilistic technique that would allow somebody to determine probability of any event logically related to the given event using probabilities of any system of events. Yun lang yung contribution niya. Marami siyang contribution, pero ito yung medyo kailangan ng highlight. Itong mga ito. Ayun lang.
Nikolai Lobachevsky, he was born at Nizhny Novgorod on December 2, 1792. His father's job was a clerk, Maximovich Lobachevsky, and his mother was Prokofia Alexandrovna Lobachevsky. At his 7 years old, Nikolai's father was gone. They moved from the city of Kazan with his brother and mother. In this time, their path was begun by entering the field of gymnasium and education. Also, Lobachevsky was enrolled in Kazan State University. His original course was take medicine but decided to change into another field, which were mathematics and physics before he graduated. He finally achieved his mathematics degree in chosen field in 1811 and be able to lecture in year 1814. Together with this exceptional and master skill in mathematics and physics and dedication to his job, he successfully became a full professor in 1822. Despite of hard words and devotion of Lobachevsky, he encountered a lot of challenges, but neither of them success to down him. In fact, he defended various mathematician researcher and contributes in mathematics, physics, and astronomy, discoveries, and enlightenment.
Good day, everyone. So, before we discuss about the contributions of Nikolai Ivanovich Lobachevsky, I will give you one fact about him. That fact is the si Nikolai Lobachevsky ay nagsuffering from severe illness, which were the unable to walk and near blind. Biruin nyo guys, sa dinami-dami ng contributions niya sa field ng mathematics, nagsuffer siya ng isang illness na maaaring mag-stop sa kanya to discover something about mathematics nga. So, meron siyang mga contributions, which are the non-Euclidean geometry and the parallel postulate. Ayun lang is, yung dalawang yon is part lang ng mga contributions niya, pero may mga contributions din siya sa algebra and other fields of geometry. So, first is we discuss about the non-Euclidean geometry. Yung non-Euclidean geometry ay pinroposed noong 1826, but na-publish lang siya noong 1829 sa Kazan Periodical. Alam niyo ba guys na dininay ng St. Petersburg Academy of Sciences, kung naririnig niyo na yun guys, that was a famous university. So, dininay nga ng university na yon yung proposal ng publication ng non-Euclidean geometry. Kaya na-publish lang siya noong 1829. So, nung na-publish yun sa Kazan Periodical, it is part of the a concise outline of the foundations of the geometry. So, by that, yung non-Euclidean geometry ay sinasabi lang noon na inaral mismo ni Lobachevsky yung geometry without dun sa axiomatic formulation of geometry ni Euclid. Yung axiomatic formulation of geometry ni Euclid ay sinasabi lang doon na merong isang line and a point that is not on the line, and the probability of having a parallel line is mababa lang, or sinabi niya nga directly na isa lang yung pwedeng mabuong line na magiging parallel doon mismo sa given line. Yung formulation na yon is merong four axioms, and tinatry nga i-prove ni Euclid yung fifth postulate as a theorem. And by that, nagkaroon or nakabuo ng concept and ideas si Lobachevsky na why na i-study niya yung geometry without yung axiomatic formulation of geometry ni Euclid. And yung in-improve niya or binago niya or in-innovate niya yung proposal na yun ni Euclid as the parallel postulate which is his next contribution. So yung pag-aaral niya na yun ay tinawag niyang imaginary geometry. Yung bale pinub niya yun at naging isang postulate. And by that nga yung probability na magkakaroon ng parallel lines na dadaan dun sa one line, sa one point na nanandoon sa malapit sa given line is infinite. Sobrang daming lines pala, hindi lang isa lang pala yung pwede nating magawang line na magpa-parallel doon nga sa given line. Isa pang fact about this proposal of the non-Euclidean geometry and the parallel postulate is merong isa pang mathematician which is si Bolyai na based on my researches nag-suffer siya from anxieties and depressions and one of the factors yun kung bakit siya namatay kasi nga nalaman niya na meron siyang same concept or ideas doon kay Lobachevsky.
So now let us proceed to the summary of our report for today. Mathematics during the 19th century developed a lot of new areas that really witnessed the discoveries in mathematics. These emerging areas gave a huge role not just to the development of mathematics but also to the world. We found out some of the works of those famous and intellectually blessed mathematicians that really contributed to the mathematical equations and established new applications that are continuously functional until up to this day. Therefore, the progress and revolution of mathematics during this era was strong and useful. Some of these are the works of Carl Friedrich Gauss that contributed in number theory, geometry, planetary, and such. Also, the works of Bernard Riemann that emphasize differential geometry, and of course, the three famous discoveries, Riemann integral, Riemann mapping theorem, and Riemann hypothesis. The Möbius strip of August Möbius shows certain types of non-intuitive behavior that makes it very significant in mathematics education. The intelligence of George Boole that expands the ideas in algebra, or mostly known as the Boolean algebra, and also in logics. Lastly, the famous works of Nikolai Lobachevsky, the non-Euclidean geometry and the parallel postulate. So to sum it all, these contributions give an important role to the development of mathematics that is still useful and functional to the world. That's all.